Okay, I think it's time to get started. This session is called Microsoft BizTalk Server on Windows Azure Infrastructure as a Service. My name is Stephen W. Thomas, and I set up a real easy email address if anybody has any questions. It's simply me@biztalkguru.com. Any questions about what you see today or any questions about BizTalk in general, just shoot it off to me. I have a few scripts that I want to run during this session, and they take about 20 or 25 minutes to execute. And I was trying to think of creative ways to fill that time. And I came up with what I thought was a pretty decent stand-up comedy routine, but the wife went ahead and vetoed that suggestion. So what I came up with instead was like a magic act. So what I'm going to do is switch over and kick off some scripts. So what I want to show you here first is my Windows Azure portal under the BizTalk Live virtual network. All I have here is one server right now. So I'm going to make, on my left hand, I'm going to make a whole BizTalk domain appear simply by running a script. And we'll come back to these scripts and look at them in more detail later. So I'm going to go ahead and kick the script off. And while that's running, on my right hand, I'm going to do a trick and configure a multi-node BizTalk environment by simply doing a single click of a script. Just to show you, there's nothing here. BizTalk's not configured. This is BizTalk 1. I have BizTalk 2 in this group. And over here, I have no databases created. So I'm going to go ahead and kick off this provisioning script, and we'll come back to this later to go into this in more detail. So while those run, I'm going to jump over to the presentation. First off, a little bit about me. So I'm a 9-year BizTalk Server MVP. They've now migrated us into Microsoft Integration MVPs because we cover a little bit more than just BizTalk Server nowadays. I run the community site BizTalkGurus.com, and I also run the singular of the site, which is BizTalkGuru.com, which is a little bit more of my my personal website. I'm co-author on a book called Applied Architecture Patterns on the Microsoft Platform. One of my other co-authors, Richard Schroeder, will be here tomorrow. He'll be talking about integration patterns in the cloud. I'm also a Pluralsight author. I have my first course called What's New in BizTalk Server 2013, which will be available in about 6 weeks or so through their content library. And I'm also a community speaker. I've done several of these events in the past. Is there anybody here that's been to one of my past presentations? No, nobody? Okay. Oh, perfect. So we have one person. So at least somebody has watched me before and chose to come back again. So everybody else should feel good about that. So let's get started with a tale of two Stevens. So is there anybody here expecting a talk on AppV, Application Visualizer? So sure enough, there happens to be two Stephen Thomases presenting here at TechEd. The other Stephen Thomas spells his name the wrong way with a V, but he's presenting on AppV. So that's why I tend to put the W in my name, because believe it or not, Stephen Thomas just happens to be a fairly common name. And rumor had it there was another BizTalk Stephen Thomas who was down in Houston. I've never actually got to meet him. And now sometimes it's great to be a Stephen Thomas. So in February, I was going to Redmond for a conference. I called up the hotel and said, I want to use my free hotel vouchers. And they're like, oh, well, it's full. And they're like, talk to the manager. So I got the manager on the phone. And he's like, oh, yeah, Mr. Thomas, we'll override the blackout dates for you. He's like, I just checked you in a few hours ago. And I'm like, well, I'm like, you didn't. And he's like, yeah, Stephen Thomas right here from Microsoft. So luckily for me, the other Stephen Thomas at Microsoft is very friendly with the hotel management. So let's give a quick overview of what we're going to cover today. First, we've got a little primer session that we're going to talk about some of the infrastructure pain points, some basics of infrastructure as a service, and then why BizTalk and infrastructure as a service are a good fit together. Then we're going to spend the majority of our time focused on development and testing scenarios. That's been a strong theme at TechEd this year, is really how to leverage the cloud for our dev and test environments. And we'll see that in action. And then last, I want to leave us with some sample scenarios, which are kind of new ways to look at approaching some of our problems now that we have other means available to us using this infrastructure in the cloud. So what I want to talk about is some infrastructure pain points. And the infrastructure pain points are really things, common pain points that I've seen in my 12 years of consulting. I've went to about 30 or 35 different clients. And hopefully you guys look at these pain points and say, that doesn't apply to me. But I think from my experience, at least every client has at least one of these. So the first pain point I see is really resource onboarding. So usually when they bring me onto a project as part of a larger initiative, and they usually bring on, you know, 6 or 8 or, you know, sometimes even 50 new resources. So I've always seen problems with the speed at which they onboard a resource. Now, most projects have a centralized development environment, like a virtual machine that they issue to developers when you join the project. And I've seen the onboarding of those resources with these new virtual machines take, on average, I'd say 2 to 3 days. If you're really lucky, when you arrive at the client site, the virtual machine's already created, but I've seen that that's not always the case. In worst case scenarios, I've seen delays of as long as a week simply for the approval process to get a new virtual machine. The next is space requirements. I showed up to one client, and sure enough, they were out of server capacity to create new virtual machines in the development environment. So we had to share the onshore resources and offshore resources, shared a BizTalk development environment. And that was all great until they said I uninstalled their code, and I said they'd uninstalled mine. And TFS doesn't like multiple workspaces on one environment, so it caused its own headaches with that. The next is in terms of support. So we're leveraging our infrastructure team who likes to solve production problems. They're good at that. But we have to use them to help us on our development environments at times. So I'm sure none of us here have done it, but have we all known somebody that's went into a virtual machine and hit shutdown instead of log off? I think probably we've all done it. It never happens during normal business hours. It's always like at 9 p.m. after a 15-hour day. I've been in these scenarios. We have to open a support ticket and then hope that somebody logs in and restarts our virtual machine. The next pain point comes to upgrades. So if we want to move to the new version of BizTalk, say we want to build out a BizTalk 2013 environment, well, we still have to support either our BizTalk 2006 or our BizTalk 2009 environment until we confirm that all that code works in BizTalk 2013. A lot of times this comes at the cost of an existing environment. Usually our dev environment will then get upgraded, and that can cause problems if we have to do fixes to existing code. Next comes to multi-server environments. I've seen very few clients that have a multi-server development environment that all their BizTalk developers have access to. Sometimes this is because you don't want your developers to maybe accidentally do something they shouldn't, to delete a message box database, something like that. But most of the time, it's purely a server infrastructure problem. Usually, your development environment is a single BizTalk server with SQL Server actually running on that box. I've seen many, many times where everything works great on a single BizTalk environment. We move to a multi-server BizTalk environment, and our deployment scripts don't work anymore, or other code functions a little bit differently than we expected it to. Next is short-lived solutions. So from time to time, there'll be a solution that only needs to be operating for maybe 3 months of the year or 6 months while we process claims from like acquiring a new vendor or something like that. The normal infrastructure in an on-premise data center isn't really set up for short-lived scenarios. And then last is the bursting scenario. And I think we're all familiar with, you know, what bursting means and what it means to run out of capacity in our local data centers. I had the honor of working the Thanksgiving and the day after Thanksgiving for a large online retailer. And I saw myself what it's like in these bursting scenarios where 6 a.m. in the morning, your BizTalk goes from 8 messages a second to 120, and then it's sustained at that level for many hours. To build out that scenario, we spent 5 resources over 3 weeks to ensure that we re-architected the infrastructure and the code to handle that specific event. So what is Windows Azure Infrastructure as a Service? It's really about making infrastructure easy. It shouldn't be hard to create a new virtual machine and get developers access to that virtual machine. It's Microsoft's pay-per-use model for infrastructure, which means if today I need 3 development environments to onboard 3 resources, I can get them in a matter of minutes. Tomorrow, if those resources aren't needed anymore, I release those virtual machines. It's made up of two key components. There's a virtual machine component, which we're most familiar with, and we're going to spend most of our time talking about today. And there's also the virtual network component. The virtual network component is what ties together the virtual machines that you create in Azure so that they can communicate with each other. And you also use the virtual networks to connect your on-premise data center with the virtual networks you create in Azure. And what the best thing about this infrastructure as a service is we're really enabling the developers to take control of their own development environment all the way back from the infrastructure level. So now if they shut it down themselves, they can log into their Azure management portal and turn that virtual machine back on. And the most important thing that I see is we're eliminating the I don't have an environment for that, which is a common response I get when I want to test out a new scenario, when we're looking at upgrading, when we're looking at evaluating new solutions. It's simply, I don't have an environment for that. And that response comes from years of people working in the corporate environment, and they know that getting a new environment takes money, takes resources, takes approval, takes answering a bunch of questions, and is really just too much pain for them to go through to get that environment. So let's talk a little bit about our site to Azure connectivity options. We're not going to focus on this too much. There's whole sessions on this. But we have a VPN connectivity option where we can do point-to-site connectivity. So I can have a single laptop connected via VPN to my virtual network. And that's very easy to set up. It takes about 10 or 15 minutes, and pretty much anybody here would be able to figure that out. There's harder VPN-based solutions that are called site-to-site connections, where you have to have a fixed static IP, and they talk about getting IT pro involvement on a router perspective to connect site to site with Windows Azure. But something else I want to make sure we focus on is that there's also traditional connectivity options between on-premise data center and Windows Azure. We can always use the service bus endpoints to connect securely back and forth, or any other approved protocols such as SFTP, FTP, web service calls. There's many different ways to connect with your back-end data center. So why BizTalk and infrastructure as a service? So I consider this the biggest wow for BizTalk since BizTalk 2004 was released. And it's quite simply because today I have complete control over my BizTalk code, I have control over my applications, but I have no control over the user accounts that are running those services. I have no control over the infrastructure that that runs on. I have no control of whether I'm running on a domain. I don't have a way to test out permissions, usually domain permissions, without involving other teams. Now with infrastructure as a service, I can put all that into my control and test out these scenarios independent of other groups without any additional effort. And hopefully by the time we get to the end of this, you'll be thinking this is pretty. Anybody work with BizTalk 2000 or 2002? Okay, so some people. So you know the big wow when 2004 came out. So hopefully you see that this is exciting as well. One of the other great things is we now have pre-built images. So we can go to an image gallery and we can select BizTalk evaluation, standard, or enterprise. And in a few clicks, we can be up and running with a virtual machine. We've also introduced a new licensing model, which is simply a pay-per-hour licensing model. And the reason this is exciting is because it can fill the gaps when we need extra capacity and also open up new scenarios that financially we wouldn't have been able to do before. And we'll get into those in more detail in a minute. We also have software mobility, so we can take our on-premise BizTalk licenses and move them to the cloud. Now, why would we want to do that? Well, maybe we do a lot of business with people in Eastern Europe. Well, we can take one of our BizTalk licenses, move it to a BizTalk server in Eastern Europe to be better and closer to them, to be able to have better connectivity for them to our BizTalk server. And I heard somebody say in the past that BizTalk was hard to install. I think anybody that worked with BizTalk 2004 remembers the days of downloading SQL, Visual Studio, downloading BizTalk, a CAB file. You'd spend a day and a half getting BizTalk installed. Now with the pre-built images, that's all that pain is eliminated, and it can be done in a matter of minutes. So let's take a look at some of the development and test scenarios. First, I want to start with how some of the announcements they made yesterday impact what we're going to see today. So first off, there's no charges for stopped VMs. I know this has gotten me before. I left a large virtual machine in stopped state and got called into the vice president's office, and she was really yelling as to why I had an $80 bill on my credit card for Windows Azure. For those of you who don't know, my wife's the vice president. So that was hard to explain to her about that. So now, no charges for stopped VMs. We're also introducing per-minute billing, which means if we run a virtual machine for 45 minutes, we're going to get charged for 3/4 of the hourly price, which is a big benefit. And they've tweaked the free trial a little bit. Now they offer you a 1-month free trial, and they give you $200 of free usage in that free trial. They've also introduced some new MSDN benefits, and that's switching to a new cache model similar to the free trial. So they're going to give you either $50, $100, or $150 each month to use towards whatever you choose on the Azure services side. Your first month, they give you a $50 extra bonus. And I asked that the money doesn't roll over, so you have to use it each month, or it's not like, T-Mobile or whoever. They also have MSDN discounts for virtual machines. They give you 33% off. So the 9-cent virtual machine will cost you 6 cents, and everything is discounted 33%. I think services, if you run Azure services, they're discounted 25%. I've not heard of discounted bandwidth or storage usage. The other big thing that they introduced was all premium disks. So your BizTalk Standard Edition, SQL Enterprise, BizTalk Enterprise are all charged at the base VM price, which means I can fire up a large BizTalk Enterprise under my MSDN account. Now you have to use your MSDN subscription for that, and it's going to be charged at whatever the base virtual machine is for that size. So in this case, a large BizTalk Enterprise is 24 cents an hour, and the normal price I think is 36 cents because then it's discounted 33%. The other important thing is you can use your MSDN software licenses now in Azure, so which means you can legally install Visual Studio on your BizTalk evaluation VM and create your own custom images if you'd like using SQL and BizTalk if you don't like the pre-built images. Anyone that's using the MSDN subscriptions today, you can simply log in to your portal and go to account, and you'll see something that looks like this. If you don't do anything, you're automatically upgraded to the new benefit on August 1st. If you'd like to upgrade sooner, you can click a link here. If you'd like to keep your existing offer with MSDN, you can opt out for 1 year from this new cash-based model. So let's talk a little bit more about dev test solutions and what those look like. So we talked about now how we have our pre-built images where we can quickly fire up like a BizTalk Enterprise, for example. But we can also create custom images. And the good thing about the custom images is we can take our enterprise standard for Windows Server 2012, convert that into a custom image, install BizTalk on there, install SQL on there, whatever we want our developers to have access to, and we can make that custom image available to our developers inside our enterprise. So even though we're opening up Windows Azure for our development environment, we can still have control over what those images are and what people run on those images using our own custom images. Now, I, for one, created my own custom image for Windows 2012 because I'm sure, like everybody, the first thing I do is go to classicshell.org and download to get my start menu. So I created my own custom image, already has start menu built in for me. There's also an API for extensions. So if you don't like anything in the portal, if you want to build your own portal to share your developer images, you can do that. Everything's exposed as a REST API. The other great thing is this is all included with MSDN. I think most developers at clients that I'm at are covered by an MSDN license. So now your developers can get up and running with these new environments at no cost to you. And we talked a little bit before about the lead time that we need to get these new environments up. Now the lead time is going to be at least 7 minutes. So to spin up a new environment for a new onboarded resource, allocate 7 minutes. Out of server space, well, that rarely happens in Windows Azure because you have the elasticity of the global cloud. And support, as we said earlier, now developers can support their own dev images, and hopefully free up your infrastructure staff to focus on more important tasks. So let's take a quick look at a demo. This is very similar to the demo we saw this morning, where we're going to create a BizTalk virtual machine using the portal. So this is just logged into a regular Windows Azure account. I'm going to go down to New, Virtual Machine from Gallery. And you can see here I have my images. So these are my custom images that I've created. You can see here my Win12 base image. Under Platform Images, these are all the images that Microsoft provides for us. So I'm going to select the BizTalk Evaluation Edition. Now, Evaluation Edition is different from Enterprise and Standard in that the Evaluation Edition already has SQL pre-installed on that for you. So literally, when you fire up Evaluation Edition, you just go to Configuration, and in about three clicks, you're up and running with the BizTalk environment. The Enterprise and Standard are going to assume you want to do more with it and assume you're going to have a remote SQL server. So we're going to put in the name. Let's do TechEd. The date 01. I'm going to leave that as a small. And you got to enter the admin user ID and password. Now, the DNS name has to be a globally unique DNS name. And this is what you're going to use to remote desktop into the virtual machine. So I'm going to use it. The DNS name is generally the same as the service name. And now you get a bunch of options under storage account, region, affinity group, or virtual network, and virtual network subnets. So depending on what your selections are here, different windows are going to appear or disappear. So I want to put this in Western Europe region. I don't want it to belong to any of my existing virtual networks or domains, simply because I want this to be a standalone virtual machine. So I'm going to put it in Western Europe, simply because I figure everybody else here at TechEd is probably using West or East. So we'll stick it over there. And then I'm going to click Next. Oh, let me go back. We can select the storage account we want to put it in. And once I select Western Europe, my storage accounts are limited to only storage accounts that exist in Western Europe. I'm going to select that. We'll select one so it doesn't auto-create a new one. This is the auto-generated name, by the way. And here we have the option to join to an availability set. That's generally more useful if you want to expose your HTTP endpoints. So the availability set will automatically load balance around your exposed endpoints. We don't want to do that for our development environment. And you have the option here to enable or disenable remote PowerShell. So I'm just going to leave that enabled. And just like that, it's spinning off and creating this new virtual machine. It'll stay here in the provisioning state for about 5 minutes. A normal virtual machine, just a base Windows 2012, takes 2 to 3 minutes. The BizTalk ones take a little longer because they're doing a little more on the provisioning side. So we'll jump back to the demo or the slides. So as we can see, it's very easy and quick to create a new virtual machine using the portal. But sometimes the portal isn't really the best place to create virtual machines. You could very easily create your own domain in the portal manually and add your disks, but we really want to get to what I call is the holy grail of a dev and test environment. We want to get to a multi-server BizTalk environment that we can easily create, play with, destroy if we need to, tear it down, and recreate it with very minimal effort. So this is what I consider the holy grail. This is what I would like every developer that I work with in BizTalk to have access to, so that they can test their code in a multi-server environment that's isolated from everything else, so they can create their own domain users, they can change permissions, they can delete the message box database if they want to, and we can easily recreate this solution. I say that because, yes, it's happened. I've got a call. Somebody deleted the message box database, didn't know what to do. So now, with these scripts, we can recreate that environment. So let's think about our quest for our holy grail. So as I said, we really want to get to a one-click deployment end-to-end. We want to have nothing. We want to click a button and end up with a fully configured multi-node BizTalk group. So when I say one-click, I should say it's the spirit of a one-click deployment. A past client, we revamped their automated deployment process, developed, we called it one-click. We gave it to the server team to implement. First thing the guy did is ran it, turned to me and said that it wasn't one-click. And it's because he had to navigate the folder structure to get to the install that bat script. So I like to say spirit of one click, might be some folder navigation involved. So we have a lot of tools available to us to help get us towards this one-click deployment. We have some PowerShell that we'll take a deeper look at in a minute on how to create these environments scripted with PowerShell. We have custom images. So if the out-of-the-box BizTalk images aren't what your organization wants to use, you can create your custom images, pre-install BizTalk on there, and leverage them with scripts as well. We have a concept called bootstrapping, which there's a lot on the internet about bootstrapping the Windows Azure virtual machines, where bootstrapping will go out to a known location, download some configuration files, and do post-creation configuration on your BizTalk virtual machine or on any virtual machine at time that that machine is being provisioned. So you can log on and you can have IaaS already installed, you can have various other tasks already created. We also have remote PowerShell, which with remote PowerShell, we can do remote administration of our virtual machines. And then last, we have the BizTalk provisioning tool. This is a new feature to BizTalk infrastructure as a service, and we're gonna dive into that in more detail in a minute. The BizTalk provisioning tool is what allows us to do the one-click multi-node configuration. And like I said, we're trying to get towards what I consider the three R's. We want something that's repeatable, something that's resizable, and something that's available right now. So as I mentioned on the past slide, let's introduce this new BizTalk provisioning tool. So what this is it's a new client tool and a server tool that comes installed on every pre-built BizTalk image that we create, every pre-built BizTalk virtual machine that we create from one of our predefined images in the gallery. So we fire up a standard developer or evaluation or enterprise, we're gonna have this BizTalk underscore provisioning folder on that virtual machine. And it's nothing more than a command line tool. You fire up the service locally, and then you fire up the client and you pass in a configuration file, and it goes and does all its magic. So it uses this XML configuration file to automatically install various BizTalk components. It creates your BizTalk hosts, it creates your BizTalk groups, creates your SQL management databases, and really gets you all good to go. So with that, let's take a deeper dive at some of the scripts we executed earlier, and then let's take a deeper dive at that BizTalk provisioning tool. So first off, I have a folder here called TechEd, and it contains scripts named 01 through 05. And these are really individual scripts that I've executed to get us to this point. So before I ran a script to create my infrastructure environment. I ran another script to create my BizTalk provisioning environment. I'd really want to tie those together, but for the sake of time, I didn't want to tie. I wanted to break it up so we could see a little bit more of what it's doing. I'm almost to the point where we have a true one-click deployment process. There's a few steps that I have that I actually do manually. So one of the things you do is I break up the creating the domain controller separate from creating the servers that are going to join to that domain. And so something I should point out here is while the portal is great for creating isolated development environments, if you want to create an environment and join them to a domain, to one of your virtual networks, you want to do that using PowerShell. And the reason is in PowerShell is the only way you can assign a DNS that doesn't get lost if the server is restarted. So the network card on a traditional virtual machine will sometimes get dropped and recreated, and using PowerShell, you can ensure that your DNS settings are gonna get reset back. So on the domain controller, when I pass in my DNS here, I pass in a loopback address because this is gonna be the domain controller. Once the domain controller is created, so there, I won't go into the details of the provisioning script, pretty straightforward, but here, I'm using the IP address for the DNS. This is the IP address of the domain controller that had already been created. Now, when you create a new virtual network in Windows Azure, the first machine you add to it is always .4. So I already knew when I was gonna create this what the IP address was gonna be. But what I wanted to do was have these machines, when they were created, automatically join the domain. And I can do that by once that domain controller is created, I ran these scripts to promote to domain controller, and then I created all my BizTalk domain users. And once I was done with that, I came back here and provided my Windows domain, domain password, username, and domain information. So when these BizTalk out-of-the-box images and SQL out-of-the-box images are created, these are using these out-of-the-box images, the provided images by Microsoft. So when it provisions those, it's going to auto-join the domain for me. So when I log into that virtual machine, it's going to have SQL already installed, already joined to my domain. It's going to have BizTalk already installed, already joined to my domain. So that brings us up to where I started the second script, where we're started on that BizTalk 01 server. So let's take a look at that. So the only configuration I did to these machines before I came in today was I logged in and ideally I'd open a firewall port for the local service that I want to expose for this provisioning tool. I just shut down the whole firewall just for purposes of the demo. And then I fired up the BizTalk provisioning service. So let's take a look first to make sure my service actually worked. I gotta close that and reopen. So let's see if we got my databases. So here's my BizTalk databases. And under BizTalk Server Admin, we can see that I'm connected to database 030. And platform settings, look at servers. And we can see we have two BizTalk servers that were all automatically configured, created, joined our group, all by running this BizTalk provisioning script. So what that script looks like is pretty simple here. And what we've tried to do is make this as simple as possible as compared to if you export out the BizTalk configuration from a group configuration page. We've really wanted to make it so there's not a lot you have to tweak in here. So we have the database features that you have to supply. And this lists you want the fully qualified domain name to your SQL database. So in my case, it's demosql01.corp.biztalkgurus.com. Then you can list all your BizTalk database names here. Let me refresh. See, I changed it to 030. So one of the things the script doesn't do is when you run it again, it doesn't delete the databases that are already there. So I keep incrementing it as I run the script. So I would put in my SQL databases. Here I can simply say what features I want to configure. If I want to configure BAM, for example, I would just set this to true, and it's going to configure it on all my BizTalk nodes. I can auto-create all of my hosts here. It's very rarely that we have, well, you don't want to have just one BizTalk host, BizTalk server application. So here it's going to actually create host A30 and host B30, and I can say what servers I want those hosts created on. Then I can specify what I want as my default hosts, so which box is going to be made the default hosts. And then I specify my service accounts down here. These are the accounts that the hosts and SSO will run under. So to get this to work, like I said, all I had to do is log in and fire up this service. So you see there's no classic shell, so that was not my custom image. So I'm lost if I have to do anything in here. But I can fire up my local service, and that runs. You want to run that as a domain admin. And then I fire up my client. And I want to make sure that the user that I'm logged into this box is a sysadmin on the SQL Server database side, because it's actually going out there and creating the databases. Now, some of you might be thinking, wow, sysadmin, domain admin, that's a lot of rights. But this is my own isolated development domain. I'm admin in this domain. I can do whatever I want in this domain. So we can execute that. Command just looks like you call biztalkprovisioning.client.exe, you pass in the XML configuration file, and about 20 minutes later, voila, you have a configured BizTalk group. So tearing down these groups are just as easy as creating them. There's other scripts here where you do stop the VM, remove the VM, remove the service. Down here at the bottom, you want to call into your disks and remove all your disks. And this kind of script would actually clean up the environment so you're back to your happy, steady state. So like I said, we're trying to get to the one-click deployment end-to-end. I'd say we're about 90% there. And the last 10% takes probably about a half an hour. So I'd say in about an hour, you can have a fully customized BizTalk domain up and running in Windows Azure. Okay, so let's take a look at some sample scenarios. And what I want to talk about here in the sample scenarios are just kind of different ways that we can look at some of the problems we have. And why is this different than, you know, in BizTalk 2010 days? Well, really, with the introduction of the pay-per-hour licensing, I think it opens up a whole new realm of possible solutions in terms of hybrid solutions in the cloud versus on-premise. You know, is for some clients, BizTalk Standard is too expensive. BizTalk Enterprise might be too expensive. Some people want a way to introduce BizTalk to the enterprise. Well, this pay-per-licensing model will really help facilitate that. In addition to that, we have license mobility. So I know some clients are running like BizTalk 2006 on hardware that literally is 6 or 7 years old. Well, now we can look at taking those licenses, converting them into BizTalk 2013 licenses, and maybe it makes sense to run some of that in the cloud because we can easily scale our virtual machines in the cloud. We can easily add RAM if we need to add RAM. We can add more cores if our license allows for it. We just have a lot more flexibility in the cloud versus from what I've generally seen on on-premise data center. So, like I said, we have easy scaling in the cloud. We're going to take a look at a second of a demo of how easy it is to change the size of our virtual machines, and all that can be done with just a few minutes of downtime. We also have the ability to go to very different geographic locations. So today, we might primarily do business in the U.S. We might have some customers in Europe, some customers in Asia Pacific. And if we wanted to contract out to data centers in those locations, we can probably do that. But it's probably a different vendor in each location, and they might have different practices and procedures to follow. With Windows Azure, I can deploy to Asia Pacific, I can deploy to Eastern Europe, just as easily as I can deploy to the East or West US data center. And something else that I should point out is that this probably isn't going to be for every solution. There's clients that have leveraged BizTalk heavily for A-to-A integration on-premise probably isn't going to be a well-suited candidate for looking at leveraging the cloud. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't look at it for new solutions that might take away capacity to your on-premise BizTalk solution. So let's talk about low utilization scenarios. This is one of the biggest pushbacks I get from anybody when I talk about BizTalk and low utilization scenarios. Generally, BizTalk isn't thought of as something that's lowly utilized. But there's some scenarios where BizTalk's only really needed during working hours. I implemented a BizTalk standard solution where it processes messages in SharePoint and then does a bunch of processing, sends out emails. It's a very mission-critical solution, but it's only needed between 9 and 5 every day. So we had to build out a whole SQL and BizTalk infrastructure to support 8 or 9 hours a day of processing. That would be an excellent candidate for using the pay-per-hour BizTalk Standard Edition in the cloud. There's also some scenarios where you might have a short-lived solution. So you need to add extra capacity for the holiday season. You know it's going to be a 3-month scenario. You need to add extra BizTalk processing. There's also cases where you may have purchased a new company. They have systems that you want to sideline, but you can't do that for the next 6 to 9 months, and you need a short-lived integration solution in the meantime. Those types of scenarios without BizTalk 2013 would require generally additional hardware, additional licenses, and a large upfront capital expenditure to make that happen. Now we could look to see if we can leverage this pay-per-hour licensing model. Costing is another thing. So I've been on a couple projects where we were building out a multi-tenant environment where they needed a very clear and defined way on how to bill tenant A for their usage and tenant B for their usage. Well, now with the pay-per-hour model, we could spin up separate isolated environments for them and know exactly what we need to charge that client. And then last, there is the compliance piece. So unless you're using a tool, a governance tool like BizTalk 360, anybody who is a BizTalk server admin has full access to everything on your BizTalk environment. So there may be compliance issues where you need to separate code and user rights into separate BizTalk environments. Again, this might be something that is better off putting some of that stuff in the cloud where you can change your access rights there versus your on-premise solution. So let's take a look at the two low utilization architectures that I've kind of came up with. First is just the pretty much basic you can get. Your domain controller can either be on-premise or in the cloud, depending on if you have site-to-site connectivity. And it has one BizTalk and one SQL. And then the other option where you have BizTalk and SQL running on the same box. Option two would have been great for my 9-to-5 solution, because that was really what they were doing on-premise, but it cost them a lot of money to get there. So what are some of the things you would think about when costing this type of solution? Well, we have the pay-per-hour option, or we have license mobility. But in both of these scenarios, I think the pay-per-hour licensing is really going to be your best bet, because now you can leverage the solution when you need it and turn it off if you don't need it. You have the ability to upgrade and downgrade using the pay-per-hour in a matter of 3 minutes. It's really that fast to resize your environment. Now, like I said, not every solution can tolerate a 3-minute outage, and those are things that you'd want to look at. Maybe this isn't the best solution, or how to implement queuing in front of that solution. You can easily schedule the whole environment to go up and down. So everything's configurable with PowerShell scripts. So if I want to shut my environment down at 5 o'clock every night, I run a PowerShell script that's done for me, turn it back on in the morning at 8 o'clock. All that's very easy to do. And then you're not billed for it when you're not using it. I'm not sure what your infrastructure people would do today if you came in and said, I'm sorry, I don't want a fractional bill for my nighttime BizTalk usage because I'm not using it at night. Currently, people don't really think that way. So let's take a look at a quick demo of how do I actually resize these virtual machines and see how simple it is. So again, it's a simple PowerShell script here. And I'm going to use that same virtual machine we created earlier. And if we look in the management portal, here's the virtual machine I created earlier. And it's in here running as a small. Now I can simply, I set my subscription details up here. So I know I'm running in a specific Azure subscription. And I simply can pass in a service name and the name of my virtual machine. And it's going to go off and resize that virtual machine. Now, if I wanted to resize everything in my domain, for example, the script below doesn't pass in the service name or the name of the virtual machine, and it'll go and resize every virtual machine that is in the subscription. So you can use wildcard characters on top of this to fine-tune what you want to have restarted and not restarted. I do that over here where I'm looking for everything with the disk name that contains my base, which is demo 40, where it'll go in and only delete those disks that have demo 40 in the name of that disk. So this takes it's already completed, so let's go take a look at that. And it's refreshing. The portal's been running a little slower than usual lately. Okay, well, it'll refresh in just a second. So I would really encourage you that when you want to look at leveraging the infrastructure as a service, to make sure you learn the relevant PowerShell commands to actually leverage things that way. And in my experience, it took creating a bunch of virtual machines using the portal to really understand what availability set was, what your affinity group was, what all those different parameters you set are, and then it makes more sense when you build out the PowerShell scripts. The other thing that's important to keep in mind is when you are looking for examples online, is you really want to make sure you're using examples that were written post the RTM, post the release of infrastructure as a service. There it refreshed and it didn't seem to reset for me. So it should have set it to medium. I might have typed in the name of the machine wrong. So anyways, you can do that via PowerShell. So let's talk a little bit about the hybrid solutions. There's actually a whole talk tomorrow on hybrid solutions with the Microsoft integration stack. We're going to look primarily on hybrid solutions with BizTalk right here. So one thing I want to keep in mind is it doesn't always mean a direct connection. So while a lot of times it does, but you can also use service bus or you could use SFTP to bridge the gaps between on-premise and the Azure cloud and still have a hybrid solution. It allows us to really bring our endpoints closer to our customers if we have customers that need that kind of level of interaction. So a huge benefit I see here is if we do business with people in Hong Kong, we do business with people in the UK, we can move that receiving the message and processing that message closer to them and then receive those messages via the service bus. We can also look at a hybrid solution that has disaster recovery. So we can have our cloud BizTalk server be our disaster recovery by log shipping our database logs up there. So what I've talked about is two different hybrid architectures. The first one is our BizTalk servers geographically located, and then using the service bus to connect with our BizTalk on-premise. Brian Lozian actually did a great blog post and video about this very same scenario about 2 weeks ago. And then what a log shipping scenario would look like. So we have our on-premise BizTalk server, and we can ship our SQL logs up probably to Azure storage. And then if we need that BizTalk server in the environment, we can have that BizTalk fully configured, fully with all our code deployed onto it, and then we simply stop that virtual machine, and it's ready to go if we need it. We just fire it back up, bring in all our SQL logs, and be back up and running. So how would we look at costing a scenario like this? Well, in both cases, I think the pay-per-hour model is going to be best for this. We might have a lot of customers in Hong Kong today, and maybe they relocate to Europe later, and we need to move that BizTalk capacity over to Europe. We can simply do that with a pay-per-hour model. If we went out and purchased the licenses and customers moved, we could obviously still move that with license mobility, but we don't necessarily know what the capacity we're going to need for that. If we wanted to move our log files to our Azure data center, we can do that using built-in storage. The Azure storage, and we're going to get three copies of those log files up in the cloud. Plus, we can enable geo-replication to have more than one data center that has a copy of that. As I mentioned, we can fully configure our virtual machine. We just have to make sure we keep it in sync with our on-premise SQL environment in terms of the latest code. We simply fire it up, install our latest code, and then shut down that virtual machine. And as we saw earlier, we're not billed when our virtual machines are shut down anymore. The next is the burst and unlimited scale scenario. So these options for a burst and unlimited scale scenario definitely get better if we have site-to-site connectivity. So that means our Azure environment can connect very well with our on-premise data center. It's just like they're totally connected to each other. We have our pay-per-instance licenses, which I definitely think is a good way to handle our bursting and unlimited scale scenarios. We can add extra capacity when we need it, and scale up as we've seen in some of the other scenarios. And it also works for message overflow scenarios. So if we have scenarios where on-premise, we know we're going to get behind, we can use queues, we can use service bus, we can use standard HTTP web service load balancing to push this stuff off to running in our BizTalk in the cloud. Again, I should note that, again, not every scenario is going to be well-suited for this type of structure, but I think it's going to open us up to start thinking about some of these things down the road. So what's this going to look like? So when I did my day after Thanksgiving fun work, which my wife definitely didn't think it was fun, missing Thanksgiving and fun shopping, but I got to work there and watch BizTalk process off this queue, and that was a prime scenario where we could have built our solution in the cloud to handle that extra capacity. Our BizTalk on-premise, read from a queue, easily could handle 30, 35 messages a second. Once we got up above that, it took significant new infrastructure and significant solution re-architecting to be able to deliver that sustained 120 messages a second. Now, you could argue, should we have built it for that capacity initially? But it's really hard to justify to the business, I need to have three extra BizTalk servers that are just going to sit idle for 364 days of the year. But in a scenario like this, this is exactly what it could have done. We could have bridged the connectivity between our onboard queue and our BizTalks in the cloud. Many different ways we could have done that, and had our BizTalks in the cloud process that extra capacity. And if we needed more, we just add additional work groups that would continue to process off that work queue, and everybody would be happy. So costing in this type of scenario, again, the pay per hour is likely best. As you see here, I keep trying to bring back to how now we can leverage this pay per pay-per-hour billing that's licensing that we have available to us with BizTalk. And like I said, site-to-site connectivity is going to be best for this if we have eliminates the firewall problem in between if we set up those VPN connections. And this type of scenario is going to be best if we have some type of queuing mechanism in front of it. So we can build up in our queue and actually work items off that queue. So how do we manage and monitor these solutions in the cloud? We have System Center 2012, which has full Windows Azure virtual machine support for finding out the health and status of our virtual machines. It also has support, I think some basic support for BizTalk Server. But we also have BizTalk 360, which we can use to get detailed process monitoring. We can get detailed business eventing of our systems. And the best thing with BizTalk 360 is it's web-based. So we can have this solution in our independent BizTalk domain, and anybody that we grant access to can have access to that through the BizTalk 360 web portal. So I think BizTalk 360 is going to add a great value for our integrated independent domains in the cloud. So as we start to wrap up, I want to focus on some infrastructure as a service tips and tricks. I've probably created or destroyed about 500 virtual machines in my past 9 months. So most of those I use the portal for. So I learned a lot about the process. So if you don't like the portal, use your own APIs or use the REST APIs. So I created my own Windows form tool that could move virtual machine disks from one account to another. It could take virtual machines offline. It could bring them back online and do a whole bunch of other tasks related to virtual machines, all using the REST API. The next is to learn PowerShell. So I take a lot of pride in being a drag and drop developer. Somebody I talked to earlier called it a line developer, where we just drag shapes onto a surface. I actually had to bite the bullet here and learn some PowerShell. That's really the best way to create these environments and be able to have a repeatable solution in building and tearing down these environments. Another thing that a lot of people have questions about is disks are only charged for your actual usage. So if I have 127 gig operating disk, I'm only charged for the actual storage that a disk is using. So it's only actually using about 15 gigs, so you're only charged for 15 gigs. Something else to note is that some properties can't be changed once they're in use. So if you create a new virtual network and you add a machine to that network and then you want to add point-to-site VPN connectivity, that can't be done when that virtual network is in use. Now, I know the networking team is working on solutions for that, so I think those limitations will be gone soon. So in summary, hopefully what we saw here is that infrastructure as a service is easy. It's PowerShell scripts, it's the portal if we want to use it. It puts the infrastructure into our hands, for better or for worse, and allows us to create these environments to execute against. We can use this right now for our dev test scenarios, especially if we have MSDN licenses. There's no reason we shouldn't be out playing around with this, creating our own domains, creating our own BizTalk environments, and testing out some of our deployment and solutions there. And hopefully we saw in the sample scenarios that we might have new possibilities where we can look at how can we put extra capacity in a pay-per-hour model? How can we not have to spend so much money on data center capital investments? How can we leverage this cloud? How can we geographically locate our BizTalk servers to better serve our customers? So hopefully we saw that those are some new things that are available to us now. And a lot of that is relates to the pay-per-hour licensing model. We can win a car. I don't have any big announcement other than you can win a car. I wish I had something better. I have nothing to give away. Some other tracks and some resources. I should get to the question slide soon. Complete your evaluation to win. So with that, are there any questions? Yes.
What about Visual Studio and OR virtual machine? I'd like to set up a virtual machine. I would like to have Visual Studio on there. Move my app over there and deploy it. So,
So with Visual Studio, now with the ability to run the MSDN licenses on the Azure virtual machines, you can install Visual Studio either in the cloud on your Azure virtual machine, or you could have it running locally, create a point-to-site VPN connectivity, and you should be able to deploy to those BizTalk servers. So it's really now you have two options. As where before, you legally couldn't install Visual Studio on your Windows Azure virtual machine. So we can do that now. So does that answer your question?
I guess
yeah. So his question was, what about Visual Studio, and how can I deploy from Visual Studio to my virtual machines? Any other questions? Yes. I'm not aware that clustered host instances is supported right now. So one of the limitations of the virtual machines in the cloud in general is that Windows clustering isn't supported. So I don't think you'd have clustered host instances available today in Windows Azure. Yeah, if you had a case where you needed a cluster service. So you can do the groups just fine, but if you wanted to cluster those services, I don't know a way of doing that right now. But I believe that's coming and things they're working on in the future. So his question was about clustered host instances. Sorry, I'm not good about that. Other questions? Yep. So his question is, he has custom code he wants to build into a VM. Absolutely, and that's the ability of creating those custom images. You would have to reproduce a lot of the work they put on their image for configuration stuff, but that's like my Windows 2012 custom image that has a bunch of stuff that I usually use. You can definitely build a custom image that does that. So. It's magic. They're provisioned and have space allocated, have resources allocated to them in the Azure data center. So the virtual machine consists of obviously the processing power, and then really the meat of it is your disk behind it. So as you create these, it creates a disk for you in the storage account you tell it to, and it creates the front end processing, which is the OS around that disk. It's simply like a Hyper-V virtual machine. It spins up and it's like a subset of that server. And then when you tear down the machine, the virtual machine, the disks will still stay there by default. So you could, before yesterday, if you didn't want to get charged, you'd have to delete your virtual machine, but you could keep the disk there and you just create a new virtual machine and say, hey, use this existing disk, and you can just start back up where you were before. So it's really two pieces. There's the virtual machine, which is, I can show you, it's simply XML configuration. So if you export out what the virtual machine is, this is what an XML configuration file for the virtual, oh. This is what the XML configuration file looks like for a virtual machine. And you can just, there's a PowerShell command like export.vm or something, and it gives you this. And you can take a look at what it looks like. It's very straightforward. So you can use this same virtual machine template to actually create a virtual machine. You could pass this in as a command and create the virtual machine. And the OS virtual disk, that's really the guts behind what this XML represents. So you could even have a BizTalk server that would create this with a map and have a BizTalk server create more BizTalk servers and have all kinds of fun with it. And then everything's exposed as a REST API as well, so you can use the REST adapter and really go all out. So, any other questions? Yes.
Anything that you can do on-premise BizTalk server if you cannot do on the VM?
Yeah. So the question is, what can't you do in the cloud that you can do on-premise? So the clustered host instances is one of them. Support for a clustered SQL server is another one of them. So that's one of the things the team's actively working on, is a highly available SQL solution that BizTalk supports in the cloud. So as it stands today, the cloud, Azure supports SQL Always On as a supportable SQL high available solution, but BizTalk doesn't officially support that yet. So some of the things they're working on is getting that high availability SQL solution BizTalk supportable in the cloud. I'm trying to think if there's... Yes. Yeah, definitely. We got another question?
Can you have custom SQL Server on-premises and
not? That's an excellent question. That's something I wanted to try myself. The big problem with that is going to be the latency, because, you know, BizTalk is going to be pulling your on-premise SQL. So it's not something I think we'd recommend going about right now. When I think of a hybrid BizTalk solution, the first thing I think of is, well, I have my existing group. I'm just going to add 3 BizTalks to my existing on-premise BizTalk group. But I don't think we're there yet from a network connectivity perspective. I'd like to see us get there, and hopefully we do. So, but until then, we look at service bus and other ways to grow our capacity without the latency issues. Any other questions? Yes. I haven't heard anything about that. The talk I have heard about is the SQL always on, which is, I think, kind of like clustering and mirroring together. I'm not a SQL expert, but when I've looked at it, SQL always on seems to be awesome. And if we could have BizTalk support for that, that'd be great. The issue is relates to the cross database transactions. Which it's something that's not always supported in those SQL solutions. Anything else?
Consider actually using a PowerShell workflow as opposed to just a bunch of standalone scripts for your process?
I would open any suggestions for making my PowerShell better. So my PowerShell is just like my SQL. I send it out to the team, and somebody responds back and says, well, you could do this better this way. So I'll definitely take that in mind. Hopefully we get it down to one click and there's only one script and we're done.
And it's so nice because you can run the process and actually maybe do multiple data jobs and individual jobs.
Oh, okay.
That's their lingo, right? So you can say, hey, here's the basic workflow, spin up a whole set, and then you can say, do this 3 times and they'll do that. And the nice thing about workflow is that they can deal with scenarios like server reboot and stuff like that where the script can't.
Oh, okay. Oh, cool. Okay. Well, that's good. That's good feedback. Anything else? Okay. Well, if you have any questions, remember it's just me at biztalkguru.com. If you put the S on there, I'll still get it. I'll be down at the booth after this and then at Ask the Experts as well. So, thank you.